communities all across North Carolina that for one reason or the other have been deemed sacrifice communities. They live in a sacrifice zone. In order for me to turn on my power in Raleigh or Durham, or for folks in Wilmington to turn on their power, somebody has to live next to that plant. So those communities are considered sacrifice zone communities. They're on the front lines of the pollution. It's not their fault. They're not choosing to live there. By no bad decision of their own, they are now in an area that has polluted air, polluted water. It doesn't have the health resources they need. They're not going to get the services that they need. They're not going to be asked the right questions. They suffer so that I can have my lights down in Durham or in Wilmington or in Raleigh. Those communities are suffering. That's a sacrifice zone. That's a sacrifice community. We are complacent in making a decision when we turn on our lights that someone somewhere is going to suffer for it. And Belews Creek is one of those communities.
Tomorrow, a federal grand jury will begin hearing evidence on whether North Carolina regulators looked the other way when toxic coal ash leaked from power plants operated by Duke Energy. Coal ash is the sludge left over when coal is burned to make electricity, and there was a massive leak of it last month in the Dan River.
On February 2nd, a pipe below a Duke Energy storage pond blew out. 39,000 tons of ashen water gushed into the river. Wildlife officials estimate a layer of sludge that included chemicals known to cause cancer traveled 80 miles downriver.
So in early 2014, I had just joined Without Voices recently, we had a major spill in the Dan River. And what happened was Duke had failed to monitor and keep up a pipe that was underneath the coal ash pond. So when that pipe failed, it gave it a perfect conduit, a perfect pipe to just unload everything that was in the coal ash pond into the Dan River. Over 89,000 tons of toxic coal ash sludge dumped into the Dan River and spread about 70 miles downstream through Virginia all the way to Carr Lake. A blessing to us was meeting Annie Brown, who on her own had started recognizing that there was a lot of sickness in her community.
Hello, my name is Annie Brown, and I'm a resident of Walnut Cove, which is located in Stokes County, where I live is about 2 miles from the Belews Creek Steam Station. And I'm here to talk about my concerns about health issues from the piles of fly ash that stacked up with grass growing on top. Also, the fly ash that was released back in the early 70s when it first started up.
My mom had to speak up because she knew that our community was looking at the same type of issues, and if didn't nobody speak about it, then this whole community would be gone eventually, and no one would have tied the pieces together.
Annie was really instrumental in forming what became the Residents for Coal Ash Cleanup in Stokes County, and what ultimately also became the ACT, Alliance of Carolinians Together Against Coal Ash.
But over the years, after I got into became acquainted with Appalachian Voices, they gave me a pamphlet that stated the toxins, the chemicals, and what they could do to a person's body. Everything that was on that body, that diagram, I have it.
Yeah.
I have it.
And more we talked about things, the more things would come to surface about, do you think this could be why this is happening? Do you think this is why we have cancer clusters in our area? Because so many people were getting sick.
It was like my half of my body, the left side just pointed in an opposite direction. My hand, my fingers was like that over here. I got it fixed. I thought this is what I ended up with. It looked like those little deformed fish that's in the water at Blue's Creek.
I had three cousins. Two of them had neurological issues, and one of them had cancer. And I know that they ate the fish out of the lake, you know, because they fish the lake often. And they all became ill, and it was really unexplainable. Let's say from Pine Hall Road, down below the entryway to Duke Energy's property, you had people with heart conditions. The three that I mentioned, there were Gloria Brown, Lonnie Brown, and Larry Brown. And they are all my cousins. Coming back up past Withers Chapel, we had a friend of mine that I grew up around, really, went to church with occasionally, Renee Harrison. She ended up with breast cancer at a young age. On down, you had Cass Harrison. He has throat cancer now that he's been battling. Herman Moore, he had cancer and he passed away from it. Cynthia Martin, she had breast cancer. She was young. The age is unbelievable, because you go from children having stomach cancer. Danielle Bailey Lash, she had a brain cancer. You had other people that had neurological issues that lived in the area. Karen Moorhead, she had a really bad stroke. She's not deceased, but she's still in bad shape. It's just so many. And that's just a small portion of Pine Hall Road. You have a lot of people with respiratory illnesses, neurological issues such as strokes, myself included. I had a series of strokes, three strokes and a heart attack. And I was 44 at the time. But like I said, it was just so many people. And the only thing in our neighborhood, the only industry in our neighborhood, is Duke Energy. And I feel like that's the cause of a lot of people's issues, because the water was contaminated, the soil was contaminated, and the air. And over a period, over 40 years, a lot of people, over time, ingested all of this.
Well, the community was just getting its head around the fact that it had contamination in its wells. And here comes the North Carolina Oil and Gas Commission that thought there might be some type of fracking play in Stokes County. And it just so happened that one of the areas that they were looking at was in the same community as the Walnut Tree, a property right in the back. And without even the Walnut Tree knowing, the town granted permission for a fracking test well to drill a core in the back of this community to see what was there. And so it really was the straw that broke the camel's back.
We have to stand up for what's right. We have to stand up for what's injustice. Amen. If it means going to jail,
amen.
I'm willing to go to jail. Yeah. We want to make sure they have a safe future.
David Harrison.
I thought at the beginning that I would just probably be one of hundreds of people just standing in the back holding the sign.
We appreciate the crowd. I'm sorry we don't have enough seats for everybody to come inside. We're not used to such a crowd. But now this meeting is set up to be run a certain way, okay?
And now here was a second potentially polluting industry and the threat of what fracking could do to that very massive earthen dam that they were sitting in front of. And the community, they rose up in the most beautiful way. Neighbor started talking to neighbor. We started meeting at the senior center. And, you know, people were networking with each other and standing up and saying, if this town is gonna grant this in our backyard without our representation, we're gonna do something about this.
We were protesting and blocking the road where they needed to get their trucks to, that they let them move the date forward before the actual date that we would have been mobilized and ready to stop them from even digging the test well. The people in the community saw them coming over there, so they phoned everybody anyway. By this time, it was too late for us to actually block them and stop them from doing, because they contacted the sheriff's department and had the land roped off. So we had to protest around them, but we couldn't stop them from actually drilling.
My mother worked hard in that cleaners up here in the sweatshop to afford that, to afford to put my sister through college, to raise us and make sure we had the better things in life. And I'm not going to stand by and let greedy politicians take away the only memory I have left for her, something I promised her just now before I come up here on her grave that I would fight tearfully. And I told her, I promise if she give me the strength, I will not let her down.
And I know the story about Blues Creek and 75 homes. Mm-hmm. You got a coal ash plant.
Yes.
Coal ash pond.
Yes.
And a landfill.
Why? Mm-hmm.
Community 61% color, but
yes.
39% white.
Yes.
Why?
So this is hurting everybody.
Everybody.
This was for low income housing. And you applied through FHA. FHA went through, the Farmers Home Administration went through, and they had Town and Country out of King that built these houses through here and a set of houses in King all at the same time.
My personal family, the Hurston side, originated from a plantation in Coulomb, North Carolina. My grandfather was probably 4 years old when his family was freed from slavery. I'm not sure about his age, but he was born into slavery. My grandmother, this is on my father's side, she was a Welsh Indian from the Sawyertown Mountains. After my grandfather was freed, he moved here to Stokes County, to Wanna Cove. That's where he met my grandmother and they got married. And they raised 8 kids that produced 28 grandkids. My father died when I was 10. My mom was a single parent and she purchased that home in the Wannatree. Till this day, I can see the joy on her eye because it was unheard of a single black mother in Stokes County, Wannacove, anywhere, purchasing a home.
The biggest majority of them were very proud to be able to get a house because, like I said, these houses was for low-income people, and most time the people that first moved in, they didn't really, you know, they didn't have the finances to really to get a decent house.
She bought that home, and when she turned the key on it, and we saw carpet, fresh paint, bathrooms on the inside, because we were raised, we had outhouses, we had a spigot was outside. When we were growing up, we would have to go outside to get water. The smile on her face to know she was a homeowner, and she had got a better place for her son and daughter by herself with no help, and working hard was the inspiration of my life. It's something I'll never forget.
And it was getting a little bad in New York, so we moved down here. I have a couple of relatives down here. We came down here, looked around, I liked the place, so we decided to move down here and give our children a chance to be kids.
You applied for the house and the spot, and applied, and this is where we end up at.
All of us grew up like sister and brother. It was a well-knit community because we were all friends. Most of us went to the same church. We all went to the same schools. We all went on church picnics together, and it was a great place to live. When you would ride through, you would see kids out playing basketball, riding their bicycles. I mean, it was everything that my mother dreamed of, was the type of place to raise her kids.
Most of them come out of trailers and things, and for a house, they was showing up excited about it, you know, being able to own my own house, being able to finance me a house and raise my family and all. And this is what, you know, that really that the people were thinking, that it was gonna be a whole lot of difference. But then on down the road, I think we find out that you start running into all kinds of problems.
Problems with the water began when the water tree was built. It was owned by a private company called Reka. The reason we had problems with the water in the water tree is because the well was dug through an old Indian burial plot. And the water tree well is sitting at the Dan River Basin, which is filled with natural gas. That's why they wanted to dig the test well in the water tree at the old well.
You get up in the morning, you turn it on, and it smells like sewage.
Got the smell that when I turn the water on, or when we take a bath, smell like eggs been burned on the stove, right up on the, with one live on the side, and the other two on this side, and that house right there. They water is kicking like a chicken.
The smell is indescribable. The color, I mean, even when you flush the toilet, you know, the water is cloudy when it comes back up. You know, when you run the water in the sink, it's cloudy.
This is what we have to buy to keep our kitchen, bathrooms, and the sinks in the bathroom up to par where we can use them.
You can turn it on at the faucet in there, and sometimes you have muddy water, sometimes you have water smelt like something rotten coming out of the pipes.
Bad water.
I got with three peoples over here, and three of us went to Redco, and we got a lawyer by the name of Joe Webster from Madison, and we got him involved in this because Redco owned the water then, and we went to work on it then, so that's been over 30-some years ago.
And finally, after 10 years, the city said they were giving the water tree city water.
This is 2017. This was just in 1970s. Should it take from the 70s this long to get water?
And the town has said that it had hooked the water tree to city water. This is the city water. The fire hydrant here, and this place here, and there's one more right up there. It's located up there.
And so I asked the question over there one day. I said, why is our water so high? They said, well, you know, they put pipes in over there. They're gonna run y'all water from the city limits. So just as soon as y'all get them pipes paid for, say your water bill will come down. It ain't came down yet, so evidently we ain't paid for those pipes.
We pay a double water bill.
Yeah.
There's two of us here, and every 2 months, our water bill is $180, $190, and it's just two of us here and two dogs.
Yeah.
Where's your swimming pool?
That's what I keep telling them.
Yeah, even,
I don't have a swimming pool. Yeah. I don't run a car wash over here.
And I'm wondering, they didn't have to tell me that. They just could have told me the truth. I mean, you know, it's going to stay like that. Wouldn't have been nothing I could have done about it anyway. But they wanted to tell me, and say, well, just as soon as y'all pay for those pipes, your water bill's coming back down the way it was. I said, yeah.
The city limit sign was set in the third house yard at the meter. At that rate, that whole line on that side would have been in town of Wanaco. They picked the meter, they picked the sign up and set it back at the first house on the other side of the meter. So no houses in this development will be in the town of Wanaco.
Look, he took man and put him in the Garden of Eden to till it and to keep it.
Yes.
Now let me open this a little bit, why we have to approach this as a not a Republican issue, a Democratic issue, but as a faith issue, a moral issue. The God we serve is the Creator. And God loves his creation. So to love God is to love the creation.
Yes.
When the Bible says dominion, it does not mean you have the right to destroy. And the reason you know that is because in Genesis 2, he says, I put man in the garden to till it and to keep it. In the original language of Hebrew, the word till is shamar. It is translated in the rest of the Bible, it means to serve. Till means to serve the land. To serve the land. The same word is used when Joshua said, as for me and my house, we will serve. We will shema the Lord.
Probably 2 miles down the road. And we just right, well, our land run right into Blues. It was just nothing but just farmland. And that's all it was, just farmland down there. And then when they came in, they just started digging it out. Then the water, you could see the water just taking it. It took every bit of it down there.
Grew up in a place called Little Egypt. And that's over where Duke Powell's got a plant at. Yeah, some of the leaves didn't want a lot of.
The black community, it was hard because you couldn't just walk into a bank and get a loan. You couldn't just walk into a store and obtain credit. And especially if they didn't know you. So it was hard because we had to put up what went in our bellies and their bellies. It was everything from the farm. You had to put it up.
If I could, and it wasn't underwater, I'd move back away and never leave. That's how much I thank him.
And I would see them feed us before they ate. So, yeah, it was a struggle.
Things changed. I hated to leave it. I didn't want to leave. You know, when you're there, you think you want to, but you don't really want to. Once you get out, you see. You know when they say, you don't miss your water, the well run dry. That's true.
I think they came in 74. In 74, I think I was about, 12 years old. And I noticed it right then when they started, whatever they started over there. And I remember how the house was covered with fly ash. We couldn't sit on the porch. The cars were covered.
When the coal's burned, it's a residue, a trace element in the ash that's left. And when that material comes in contact with water, the selenium dissolves and goes right out with the wastewater. There were two power generators at Blues Lake. The first was put online in about 72. The second one was around 74. By 76, things started to go downhill. By 78, the fish were virtually gone. So it happened that quickly.
When the water changed, it almost turned me from water because it tasted bad. You know, it smelled bad. Right now it makes me itch when I get in the tub. You know, I can't buy enough water to take a shower. And it just affected many aspects of my life.
Once it gets in the water, it accumulates. It's taken up in the small aquatic plants and the small aquatic organisms. It accumulates in those and it biomagnifies up the food chain.
Big business and people like them, they just want to move you to the side so you can leave them alone and they don't have to hear you. You know, they want you quiet, but the whole time you're suffering. you're suffering.
Come on then.
They want the benefit on the backs of people that they think won't fight back and can't fight back, but I want you to know today that they will fight back and you're gonna get a lot of help.
I was employed for Duke Energy. Duke Energy was good to me. But I knew that they had that fly ash and some of the different other things. I knew some of the things that happened to our cars where the paint would actually come off the cars from that stuff. So I knew all about it.
I'm Vernon Zellers, and I live 1275 Old Plantation Road, Walnut Cove, North Carolina, 27052. And I've lived here since 1996. Got a small place, 8.5 acres, all in oak wood. Quite happy with living in the country. My wife and I married in 1967, married 48 years, and she died last July. Brain cancer, anyway, she worked at Duke Power as a security guard for 7 years at the front gate, so we moved here before any of this happened, and we wanted a quiet place, and we found this place and moved in. I was a commercial roofing consultant for 35 years, she was a human resource administrator.
Previously, we lived at on Pine Hall Road, down near Blues Creek Steam Station. We lived in three different areas on Pine Hall Road near that whole area.
We actually started out right beside their first landfill. So, plus, I worked for 26 years.
And what did you do for Duke Power for 26 years?
Leaving that in charge of the fly ash.
I lived in rent houses till I bought this one. And when I moved to Warnaco, I liked to drink. Now, I ain't kidding about what went on around here. All I do is work and make me a living. I don't think people knew, understood the damage it was doing. They wasn't aware of it.
Started in 1985 when I got out of the military. And we actually tested the fly ash, see if it was good, bad, could be sold or hauled to the landfill. If it was be hauled to the landfill, you put it on dump trucks, you hauled it to the landfill, and of course, dozers pushed it off into the hollows or wherever. Once you got so much in it, then you had to cover it with 2 feet of dirt and sow it in grass. When it first started, it was just dirt. There was no liners.
We worked in the boils and replaced pipes in the boils. And we had to go in there and work. We were wearing respirators. And sometimes you'd have arsenic in those, in that fly ash. I wore a monitor. And at one time, it went off. We couldn't work in there for 2 days because the levels in the ash, the what's called the levels, were high inside the bowl. And quite actually, no arsenic is a dangerous thing.
Oh yeah, you came home gray from the fly ash, and depending on the direction of the wind, everything coming out the smokestacks back during that time, it covered your vehicles, yard, houses, whatever.
Not too much of leaving the windows open because, you know, when the spring comes and you open the windows, everything landed on the furniture, the carpets, your sofa, you could see it on the furniture, so.
Certain times, what they call bringing a unit down or bringing a unit up, it actually blows out like little chips and chunks. And it would actually eat the paint off your vehicles if it stayed on out too long.
But every day she come home from, and her car, she has a white convertible, and her top would be black from the soot that comes out of the chimney. So they weren't cleaning it up as they claimed they were.
Well, the thing that I was concerned about if it take paint off cars, what was it doing to the inside? Oh, it ain't gonna hurt you.
So you were told it was safe?
Yes, it was.
I don't think any company is fully, you know, tells the employee 100% of what they're dealing with. It just doesn't happen.
Very first thing to understand about coal ash is this is a problem that did not have to happen. Well, the utilities could have when they were burning coal, and some in the country did, just simply load the ash up and move it uphill, store it dry, away from the river, out of the groundwater. We wouldn't be having this conversation. And communities around the Southeast and in North Carolina wouldn't have had this problem. But instead of doing the simple, straightforward, responsible thing, the utilities voluntarily created millions and millions of gallons of water pollution. Instead of moving the dry ash uphill, they took advantage of the fact that they were situated near a river, and they took advantage of the fact that water runs downhill. So they sucked water out of the river, mixed it with this industrial waste, causing a problem that did not otherwise exist, and then they flushed it, they say sluiced it, downhill, usually through a ditch, sometimes through a pipe, into a large unlined pit. Millions of tons of industrial waste that contains arsenic and lead and mercury, substances that mobilize into our environment when they're mixed with water, and then it's held back from the river only by a dike made of earth that leaks. Nobody has more money in our cultures in the Southeast than the utilities, electric utilities. They are monopolies created by law. They're guaranteed to make money, and all of us have to buy electricity from them. They measure their revenues and their profits in the billions. An incredible power source, and I don't mean electric power source, I mean political and cultural power source. They play politics very actively, and they contribute millions of dollars directly to politicians and directly to political parties, but they also spend millions of dollars on lobbyists and lawyers and consultants and public relations officials and ads to tell people who by law have to buy their electricity how great it is to buy the electricity from Duke and what a great job they're doing.
In this area, railroad track is over here. They dump the ash there, the children go in and ride their bicycles up on them and play on it.
I moved here in 1979, and when I moved here, along those tree lines were some train tracks that they have picked up over the years. All this area in here was a coal ash dump. This whole area in here, it's overgrown now. Right beyond those trees there, there's a trailer park. And right across the street from that trailer park is the walnut tree. She had friends stayed in that trailer park beyond this tree line. And they used to watch the trains come in, and they used to come over here and watch what they were doing. They used to ride their bicycles in that stuff. None of us knew what it was.
Come in ashy and gray. Go get your bath. You know, it was just natural. Didn't think anything about that.
We had big apple trees and peach plum trees, and we had muscadine vines, cherry trees in my neighbor's yard, and we all used to go ahead and eat from it. It was good fruit. It was beautiful, but it was just good fruit. Those were the type of things that we would eat from as kids. We just had fun and played hard. We'd eat blackberries, wild blackberries that you find along the edge of the woods. We'd eat those all day long. I mean, you know, if you stayed outside, you never got hungry, that's for sure. And we had stuff on it. We just dusted off. It's not like we take it in the house and wash this stuff off. You know, we were kids. We dusted it off. We had no idea. You know, as long as it wasn't a spider attached to it, then we were good. You know, we thought we were. We had no idea that ash that was falling down would eventually cause us harm.
Both our children, one of my children, my youngest one, he was sick from birth. And we actually lived right there beside the flash when I got pregnant with him and gave birth to him. It was a very hard pregnancy. He was very sick from the time he was born and all the way up until now. He still has bouts with asthma, bronchitis. He has all of that, from eczema. We went to every dermatologist, every skin doctor you can imagine he's been to, and he's only 23 now. A lot of ours, especially with my son with the asthma issues, like you said, in the African American community, we see that a lot. I was very healthy. He was very healthy. And I know it could happen to any child that's, you know, could have problems, but I was not expecting my child to be that sick because I was healthy. But from the time I got pregnant, I had to come out of work early. I was sick the whole time. I couldn't eat. I was nauseous all the time. It was just a sickness that, not normal pregnancy at all. That's what they kept telling me. It wasn't a normal pregnancy, and nobody can tell me why.
We are really, I tell you what, since we lived around in here in this area, I've seen that we lost the most people on a lot of different, most of them cancer.
Because we was told when they built the plant, they knew down the line that it would be issues. They knew it. So this, what's going on is no surprise to them. They knew.
No, we ain't gonna
catch
them.
And a lot of people that started out with us, moved here, they're dead and gone. And I'm going to tell you what I told my husband. I don't know what it is about just this area right here, but practically everybody that have died right here in this community have had cancer. Mm-hmm. That's no joke. That's no lie. That's a fact.
That's a fact.
Cancer. Some type of cancer.
Very early on, we did some limited well testing all around Belews Lake, and we saw numbers come back from our testing that had us concerned about the health impacts. Anecdotal evidence that there was something seriously going on with the health of this community.
There's no question that there are interactive effects of some of these chemical elements in coal ash. For example, mercury and arsenic and selenium, they can all work together in terms of increasing toxicity to a fish, let's say. Also, if you're considering, you know, human health, things that accumulate like mercury and selenium, you have both of those at one time.
And it's miserable because people are losing so many parts, you know, like I lost my leg due to dialysis. I lost my kidneys, I believe, due to pollution. If I'm drinking water, my kidney's gone. And it's sad because we're paying for it. Like they dumped the fly ash in the river. DuPont would not want to pay for that. They want us to pay for that.
I think I remember, I can go back a long ways with it, you know, but like I said, I've seen some little changes, but it ain't been a whole lot of changes in Wanaco.
We've been going backwards to going forward from the time I was a boy. And every town around us is growing. And Wanaco is sitting still, is lost in time.
I really think that they thought we deserved to be heard. Duke Energy and major corporations and people with money in general think that the small minority of people don't have a voice, but they do have a large voice once we all band together and make our voices heard.
We have been fighting in this area for the last 38 years, ever since the plan came down and set up. I know all about the politics of Stokes County, because the last 38 years I've been fighting the politics of Stokes County, the politics of North Carolina.
I come here with a national perspective, although I have looked a lot at North Carolina, because North Carolina does happen to be ground zero of the coal ash, and Stokes County is in the center of the controversy.
This is the community of Walnut Tree. The citizens here are also people of color. The deep purple shading indicates that this area is one that is 80 to 100% people of color.
It is as if we assume that because these communities are rural, lower income, communities of color, that their ideas and that their knowledge is not valuable. No, they are not engineers, but they have had more out-of-the-box visionary thinking and problem-solving skills than DEQ ever had.
So what you're doing is putting the burden on people who do not have the resources, perhaps not the education, but certainly not the resources, to either bring citizen suits or even understand the issues in front of them, because they're very, very technical. If we're talking about groundwater monitoring data, we're talking about engineering studies of stability of ponds, it's all extremely complicated.
Because as I told the Channel 1 code, none of us ever get stuck up on our forehead. And that's the way it makes us feel like we are stupid, but we are not. We understand what's going on. All we're asking is the right to have clear drinking water, clean up the coal ash, be annexed into the town of Walnut Coal, so that we have a covering, that we have support where we are. Now, if they don't want us in there, that's fine. But we're going to continue to fight, and if we don't fight, our children will fight.
Soon after, law-abiding citizens, including some people in this room, reported the legal violations, some of which led to the criminal convictions of Duke County. Instead of the law enforcement officials, those are DEQ, we're supposed to enforce environmental laws, coming to us, that is the citizens groups, to help enforce the law, they almost immediately began meeting with Duke Energy's lobbyists and lawyers to come up with a strategy to frustrate enforcement of the law by the law-abiding citizens. It's exactly the opposite of what I learned growing up in Oconee County, South Carolina. You report a crime to the sheriff or lawbreaking to the sheriff, and the sheriff works with the victims of the crime and the law-abiding citizens, not the lawbreaker.
It's like, here's the way I look at it, if I can talk in the vernacular. It's like, we've got 150 million pounds, 150 million tons. It's like wrestling with a 150 million ton bull, right? You gotta take the bull by the horn. We've done that, we're wrestling with it.
Because Mr. Reeder was sitting there lying to those people, and I know in my heart, and I know he knows he's lying to those people about what Duke Energy or what he stood for or what DEQ was doing at that time.
It's safe, protects public health, it protects the environment, and it does not provide a disproportionate impact to any member of this state in the future again.
I know Mr. Reeder was just a paid advocate for the company, and that he would tell anything to the commission to get his paycheck.
We're doing everything we possibly can to fix it.
Yeah, but I guess I'm wondering, what can be done for the families who are affected right here, right now? Families who are having to pay extra money for health care. I'm sure some of the seniors are having to go to the rest homes and nursing homes earlier. And we sure right. have to pay 20%, if not more, of that monthly cost.
Right,
what can government do right now?
Well, that's a good question, man, but I guess I hate to answer you in this way, I really do, I'm an environmental regulator, and all I know about is environmental regulation. I'm sorry about that, but I don't know about other things, so social services and things like that in the government, I just don't have any expertise in that area.
It strikes a nerve with me when If you've got a legitimate argument, I'll sit there and argue with you all day long patiently. But when you're sitting there blatantly lying about how you are killing the people that I love with toxic water, toxic air, and toxic food from their gardens, I can't stand for it.
I heard Mr. Reeder speak of how well this administrator is doing. This administrator is not doing anything for the African American community. Voting record, their voting record is for Duke Energy. Our governor is a former employee of Duke Energy. What he's doing, he never spoke of the community or apologized for the poison that they have dumped on us. He speaks of the administration, what this administration has accomplished. They hadn't accomplished anything for the people that lived through this. I've lived through it for 40 years they've been here. I lived through the loss. Until you have lived what we've lived and lost like we lost, you can live down there in Raleigh where y'all got purified water, but our only water is well water. Our only family lives here. My only mother is dead. Tracy's only mother is dead. You can talk about 10 years from now, but who will I lose in those 10 years? Thank you. We'll take a tour of Wanna Cove and I'll educate y'all on the great historical feats of this large metropolis. With probably a population of 1,200 people, if that. This is my mom's church, the church I go to and where I grew up, St. Mary's United Methodist Church. This is Hairston Street. Got one named after me. This is where all my dad's brothers live. And this school parking lot, the house that I was born and raised in before my dad died, actually existed right here in this parking lot. And this is the graveyard where my parents are buried. I remember my dad a lot because I was only 10 years old when he passed away. And all of my memories of him are from that home. That's what makes this house over in the Wanna Tree so important to me. It's because after my dad died, my mom raised my sister and I by ourselves. In 1972, it was unheard of for a single black mom to be able to purchase a home with two kids. But my mom done it. It's always been emotional and a memory that'll be etched into my mind forever. Like a big oak tree, my roots are buried here deep. Out of the 50, soon to be 59 years that I've been on this earth, all of them but 6 months have been here in Wanna Cove. I love this town. A lot of people think that African Americans don't really love their country or their town, and they're terribly wrong. What we do disagree with is how we've been treated during those times. And all we're fighting for is to let people know that we love our town, we want to contribute to it, and we're just like anybody else.
First of all, they won't annex you. Been asking for years.
Yeah.
Now we know partly why that is because of the votes.
Exactly. Yeah, there you go.
When they say that, they say they listen, but they can't stop it. Well, that's not true. That's not true.
If they gonna annex, and we ain't got nothing, we still gonna be on the back burner.
But you'll have the right to vote. And vote different people in that may be able to help you with your water situation and getting the road scraped and trash pickup. How would you feel about that?
Now that'd be pretty good. If they get the road scraped, because when it snow, we don't get nothing. And I done walked from here down to 65 to see how the roads is, so my wife can go, let me go down there and see what the road look like.
But the state will tell you they'll scrape that front road, though, won't they? So people can get to work and do power. But they won't scrape the back roads, right?
No, they ain't scraping the residential area now. Sure. We ain't getting scraped. You scrape yourself. I don't know what's like I say, ain't no politics, man. If you talk a good game and you want me to vote for you, let me see what you're gonna do.
Do you think any of these problems are racially motivated?
See, man, that's the question right there. I've been waiting on that question.
In 1972, when we moved here, the city limit sign was actually placed right here. As a child, when I was mowing the yard, I used to have to mow around it. After the water issue came up, the city actually moved the sign, because if one house in the Wanna Tree was in the city limits as a community, they would have to put the whole Wanna Tree in the city limits. So instead of doing that, they moved the sign back about 100 feet to move our home out of the city limits.
Moving in here, we was promised that we'd be connected to the town of Wanaco, and that never haven't taken place to yet.
Some kind of help for the peoples that lives over here in the Wanna Tree, trying to get them good drinking water, trying to get them the same benefits that the town have. So, you know, it's been a struggle.
Everybody signed a petition to be annexed into the town. And we went before them and we spoke to them and they heard us and they denied it. Should it take this long to get water, lights, trash pickups, same rights as everybody else in this town?
It's two different regulations for annexation. One did you had to have 100% participation, and there was another one where you only had to have 65% of participation. So we tried the 100% participation before. And a lot of the homes were owned by mortgage companies. Some were owned by people that had moved out of town. And it made it very difficult to get 100%.
First up tonight, David Harrison. How you doing, Mr. Harrison?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
I think you've been here before, so you understand the process.
Yes, I
do.
David Harrison, 1120.
We came back with the petition thinking that we had 100%. Then they had it verified and stuff. We didn't have 100%. So we went back to the drawing board. We filed it under another ordinance for the 65%. So we went back and we got the same, like 99% that we did. One mortgage company we couldn't find that owned the home. We called them and they said the home belonged to another mortgage company. So that we couldn't get to 100%.
Zip code 27052.
Yes, sir.
I'm here to speak on behalf of the people from the Wanna Tree once again. I know the annexation is on the agenda for tonight.
We had evidence that they had annexed two other communities that were predominantly white people into the town. And they were forced into the town unwillingly. And we were willingly wanting to be annexed, and they wouldn't take us.
A town will never prosper if they put money above people. We're here tonight, and I heard this gentleman at the public speaking, talking about they paid dearly to be forced annexed. The Wanna Tree has paid dearly.
Because, unfortunately, I didn't really challenge this until here recently. We really didn't challenge the data, and based on the numbers here, I find there's too many issues to say with reasonable confidence that this is an accurate representation of the area that they have called.
I know that she did not want the people in the Wanna Tree in town.
You know, this is like the whole southeastern corner of the county.
And that is the role she played on the town council the whole time, that no one knew as much as her. Her spouting off was just her way of thinking that everyone in the audience was not as intelligent as her.
Because, unfortunately, I didn't really challenge this until here recently. We really didn't challenge the data, and based on the numbers here, I find there are too many issues to say with reasonable confidence that this is an accurate representation.
Commissioner. Let me say this. We either go vote to an annex or we're not going to vote to annex.
Now, all this beating around the bush. All this going around the bush. Keep on bringing this. I can bring up something now to the end of time. Now, if the man, that man is the expert in it, and if he said that data's right, whatever data do you want? You got some more data? Now, either we're going to vote for this thing or we're going to vote against it. I'm tired of this beating around the bush. Let's get it done.
Well, I know what you're saying, but if the petition is not done correctly, it doesn't make any difference how we vote.
Well, how are you going to correct it, Mayor?
Well, I think...
How you going to... We got a lawyer down there. How you going to correct
it? I think I asked you. Did we cross the T's and dot the I's, correct? I mean, what else more can we do? I mean, it's either done one way or the other. It's either done wrong or it's done wrong.
Well...
And there's no sense in making a vote if it ain't done wrong.
Well, if you're going to vote it down, you're going to vote it down. If you're going to vote it up, you're going to vote it up. It's time for this trying to bring in little things to disrupt. Instead of going on, they've done all they can to get the petition right. And you want, what else can they do?
That's when the town council finally voted on it. And they voted against it. They voted against annexation 3-2.
I hope everybody realizes how tough, how easy it is up here on this. It's not an easy day. No, man, no more public comments, I'm sorry. I apologize.
And I determined that day that was her last day on the town council.
In the opening pages of my holy book, the Bible, when God creates the world, mm-hmm. God says that everything he created, very good. And the word in Hebrew is tov miyad. That's what it is, very good in Hebrew, is tov miyad. He said the water was good. Mm-hmm. He said the air was good.
Yeah.
Brother Derek. He said the land was tov miyad.
Yeah.
And God entrusted humanity not to destroy the environment because when God made it, it was tov miyad.
Yeah.
Very good. Which means that anything we do that destroys the goodness of God's creation.
Very good.
Is sin.
Yes, sir. Amen. Amen.
Your water can be used for drinking, cooking, washing, cleaning, bathing, and showering. And this was dated on the 25th, but they still bringing me bottled water. And the date is the 14th of October. The guy that came, he was out of Raleigh, but he was also contracted to a DuPont. It's gotta be something to it. They bringing me water out here every 2 weeks. They brings me 30 gallons of water every 2 weeks. And now they're saying there's nothing wrong with the water, but they're still bringing it. They say they're bringing it for up to, I think, maybe about 6 months. Like I was telling you, this neighbor down the hill that just had the newborn baby, he's been coming up here asking me about water. And I gave him the number to call, and they would not call him back for him to get water because he got a newborn baby. So they buying, he have to go buy his water.
And then last year, we heard that the water tested poor in my neighbor's places around here with chromium and lead and arsenic. So I had my water tested, and it tested. Come back, do not drink, do not give it to your animals, do not bathe in it, kind of scenario. Carcinogenic toxic materials in my water. So I've been getting 6 gallons a week from Duke Power, delivered by the coffee man every week he comes in. Because Duke Power's policies have led to the pollution of the groundwater here over the years. Coal ash filling pond was not lined when they built it, and it's just over the top of the ridge about a quarter of a mile. It has leached down our water table now, and so all these wells around this area of the country are polluted and can't be used. They put these $5 billion filters in a couple of years back, five I think it's been now, and they're supposed to make air breathable. But every day she come home from, in her car, she has a white convertible, and her top would be black from the soot that comes out of the chimney. So they weren't cleaning it up as they claimed they were, okay? And she was told not to take any water out of the lake because it was contaminated. They knew that. They told all the people who worked there, don't use the water out of the lake. It's not to be used for human use. And she was aware of that, and she heard a lot of the employees and contractors talk about going fishing there, and they find out they caught the fish. They had open sores on them and all kinds of stuff in the lake, so it was bad news. That's what people talked about over there. Boy, you know, they say, well, we had a bad day today. The wind was up and blew all the coal ash right back on the administration building. It was from the east. The east wind just kind of made a loop out and just covered the building. Today, you find that today. Today, you go over there, you'll see a bit of white steam, and when the wind slows down, you see a blue haze. That's your fly ash. They didn't filter out. It's there. It's very easy to see. And to maintain her lifestyle and career, she just said, well, we know it's there, it's something we have to live with, but we didn't realize how dangerous the stuff was. You know, you talk about dirt, well, dirt's dirt, big deal. But when we talk about coal ash, we didn't understand what was in coal ash. We weren't smart enough to go get our encyclopedias and do research, so we didn't know what was coming out of that chimney. If you worked at Duke, they were trained, the managers trained them that if you want to keep your job or retirement, you don't say anything about it. If you want to get fired, just go to the guy and say, I got coal dust on my car, you're gone tomorrow morning. They'd find some reason to get rid of you. My wife died of cancer, rare brain cancer. I queried myself what was around our place that would cause that. And I said, well, she worked at Duke, so she was exposed to it 8 hours a day on her job. But then around our house, we had the soot falling, and we find it on furniture, our deck furniture, and on the deck, sweep it off. And I was concerned because I had a cat that was an outdoor hunter. She ate whatever she could get a hold of. And she died a month before my wife did with the same symptoms my wife had. Like one day, my cat couldn't pick up her feet. She couldn't move. She couldn't eat. She couldn't do nothing. So I took her down to the vet and said, what can we do? And David Cowan, our vet, said, we don't know what's wrong with her. We don't have a clue. They kept her for 3 days, and she lost her body functions, mind control, just the way my wife did. Couldn't move her feet, couldn't move her tail, couldn't eat, couldn't drink. Pretty soon, she just laying there, a fluff of fur. That's all she was. And so I had her put down. And that was in February 2nd. March, I started taking my wife to the hospital with the same conditions.
A lot of the stuff that I done that was young and stupid and wild that worried my mom, if I had to do it all over again, I would try to live my life to not make her worry. I would, at times, at 16, I was wild, I would leave. I had a lot of friends that were older than me and go to the beach and not tell her, and she'd be worried to death, don't know if I'm laying in a ditch somewhere dead or stuff. I was wild enough at one point that my mom probably told me that I wouldn't live to be 25. And on my 25th birthday, I rolled up in her yard and told her, I made it.
What'd your mama say?
She started laughing and said, you still got a ways to go. Probably wasn't a day gone by after I got a little older, maybe my 30s, 40s, that I wouldn't come over here and not tell her she was right about my friends, about partying and wasting all my money, and just the little things that a parent's gonna tell you that you think they're just being hard on you. It's all true, and they're doing it because they love you. They don't want to see anything happen to you. And I think the really being wild like that, that I didn't never take to the limit to end up dead or in prison or something like that, is because of the values that she instilled in me.
Every community, it seems like, has their leaders. They have those folks that they really, really trust. And David was a great example. Is when we first started talking to people in Louise Creek, we had so many people say, well, have you talked to David Harrison? And what's David's take on this? What's David's thoughts on this? So we realized very early on that David was one of those community members that was an anchor community member for a lot of other folks. And I think it becomes a personal growth when you realize that there's something wrong in your community and that somebody could have prevented it and should have prevented it, and that the government isn't stepping up to protect you, and the only thing standing between you and disaster is what you and your neighbors are willing to stand up and fight. So it's been amazing to watch David, from sitting at the back of these meetings, sort of taking it all in, to slowly moving towards the front of the meetings and asking more questions and talking to his neighbors. And now he's speaking at international conferences across the Southeast.
I thought at the beginning that I would just probably be one of hundreds of people just standing in the back holding the sign. I didn't think anything about that I would somehow end up leading the fight or being on the front row of the fight.
I was asked to speak on the impact that coal ash is having on the community. I lived it for almost 42 years.
My only regret is that I didn't get in this fight 40 years ago, that my mother would get to see, was still be living to see it, and the other people that was fighting for it.
You know, sometimes, like Jesus, we gotta be willing to be crucified.
Amen. Right.
In order to be see a resurrection.
Yeah.
Dr. King said, when machines and computers and profit motives and property rights are considered more than people, then we are a soul sick society.
Yeah.
I thought it was a travesty. I had talked to some of them, and they were determined to vote it down, and I told them it was not fair to not annex them, and they would be to our advantage. So, but they didn't want to annex the Warner Tree, and I believe also they didn't want to annex the Warner Tree because of the black vote over there. And it'd be impossible for some of them to get back on the board if the Warner Tree was involved.
After that moment when they voted it down, a lot of the people in there were disappointed, and I calmed them down. I said, don't worry about it, our lawyers have this.
I warned them they was gonna fire what I said. And they act like they didn't understand what I was saying. I said, they gonna sue. And I said, they ought to. I told them. I said, they gonna sue. And they act like I didn't exist. And went right on with it. And they including the last mayor, he went along with it, which I thought he would be reasonable. They said, well, we're not prejudiced. And I said, well, I said, if y'all were them and see what y'all have done and was in their shoes, what would you think?
After growing up from the 60s on and seeing, I went from an all-black school to a segregated school, and I'm used to having to deal with stuff like that. And it only encourages and lights my fire to prove that I am more intelligent than you are.
There was a young man named Charles Byron. His yard was in the town, but his house was in the county. And he ran for mayor. And one of our commissioners waited, let him run.
And that's just the role she played on the town council the whole time, that no one knew as much as her.
The commissioner waited to the last minute and then told him he was not qualified just before voting time. Meanwhile, I found out about it. So I wasn't done the right either. This person was not aware that I was gonna do it and ran, because there would have been, that lady would have ran unopposed. So she would automatically got been the mayor. So I ran against her. I went around, knocked off the door on a Saturday, and I didn't get like I should have, but I did some. I told people to vote. They come, I vote for me, I'm on the thing. I said, I'm gonna write in, you know. So they did. That's how I won it.
If you'll place your left hand on the Bible, raise your right hand and repeat after me. I, please state your name.
I, Charles.
The icing on the cake was making sure to let those people that wanted to keep us out of town know that they didn't run the town.
I appreciate it.
We were going to win because they tried every trick in the book to keep us from that, but their own lawyer had told them that we, one way or another, that this was going to happen.
Big corporations, and Duke Power is one of the biggest, takes their dark money and slides it to congressmen and committeemen in the state government to get votes their way. That's why you can't get anything done with Duke's. Too much money. They buy people off. And I have a little health problem. I had a stroke in 2017, and then I had one last week. I was in the hospital, blood pressure 240 over 200. It affected my brain, my vision. I'm not clear-headed like I was before. And other people have had more direct effect from the pollution than what I have. My neighbor over here, 300 feet or so from me. The Donaldsons have three horses and they're told by the state, don't let the horses drink your water because of arsenic in it. Don't put it on your garden and green crops and eat it because then you'd pollute yourself. I've got two little creeks are polluted. I can't get those clean. There's nothing they can do with it. Not even Duke can do anything with it because the pollution has to be remediated according to the government. And that means hauling away millions of tons of dirt. How deep do you have to dig to get the water table up? I don't know. The people have to finally get the will and backbone of the country that our forefathers had to make a country and redesign how they manage it. And the people we had now are managers of money. They're not managers of country. They're not taking care of this country at all. If they make enough money they can retire, that's all I'm worried about. And they're worried about protecting their investment, not protecting the people here. Well, I have a brother down in Alabama. He's invited me down there with him, and his wife wants to help take care of me with my health conditions, and that is fine with me to be on some of my family that loves you and takes care of you. But at the same time, I don't want to be a burden on them, so I am well enough to help myself. But I'll go down there. It's warmer weather. Won't be freezing in the front porch. But I could go anywhere. Once I eliminate my worldly goods, my bed and chest of drawers and all that stuff, I don't have to carry around with me. I can very well be a vagabond in a car and drive around with a couple suitcases and go in good weather. I'm not wedded to this place. I can go wherever I have a place to go. And that's probably what I'll do. So no matter where I go in this country, in America, I will find someone to help me if I need help. We are still a gracious nation when it comes to personal involvement. It's just too bad we have let greed and corporations rule so much of our life. They dictate what we buy, where we live, where we work, and you can't change man away from being greedy and wanting to live right as he sees it.
But serving the Lord is more than calling his name.
Yes, sir.
Calling God's name.
Yeah.
Serving the Lord is treating people right.
That's right.
Serving the Lord is loving people.
Yeah.
Serving the Lord is protecting people. Yeah. Serving the Lord is healing people.
Yeah.
Serving the Lord is caring about people.
Yeah.
And caring about community.
Yeah.
Serving the Lord, if you can't serve the Lord and mammon, you can't have two masters.
That's so.
And I don't care how much money Duke Power has, Duke Power is not God.
Amen.
I know a God that got more power than Duke Power.
Yes, sir.
Power from another quarter. It's time. It's time.
We realized that that was one of our major concerns in the community after getting annexed, is giving our kids a safe place to play. After my mother passed away, I ride through the community and I noticed that a lot of the kids had their basketball goals and swings and were riding their bikes in the middle of the street. And we had already formed the Walnut Tree Community Association, so at the next meeting, that was our topic of discussion. What are we going to do to help move our kids out of the streets?
Well, I've been a resident over here for the last 38 years. And we're finally getting a playground over here for, well, my kids are grown, for my grandchildren.
We had like a big party that day. The first day we had to dig all of the holes, mark everything. So we broke out the grills and the music and had the kids out here. I mean, it was an amazing thing. I felt like a child again, being in my old childhood community and seeing all my family and friends helping participate in it. I think this right here is just revived hope in the people and that we can make a better community.
So Belews Creek was one of the few areas that did not have any water lines close that they could even tap into. So they were unable to be provided clean municipal water. So what happened instead was they are getting full house water filtration systems. One of the interesting repercussions of that is that now Duke Energy is literally on their property, sending people onto their property to check the filter. So they now have a very personal up close relationship that Duke will always have access, always be on their property, and be responsible for maintaining safe drinking water.
It was not just only my mom's dream, it was the other kids that are in this with me, it was their parents' dream too. All I had to do was go out, ask them once to become a member of the Walnut Tree Community Association, and all of them dived on board. Even the ones that don't even live in the Walnut Tree anymore, they are card-holding members of the Walnut Tree Community Association. I've always kidded, because people told me I talk a lot, that everybody's born with a talent. And God gave me the gift of gab. And I'm not going to let him down. I'm going to talk, and I'm going to preach. I'm going to talk truth to power. And I'm going to change poor little Walnut Cove. Not just the Walnut Tree, but the whole town of Walnut Cove. We're gonna bring everybody together.
Thank you, Alfred.
Clean it up.
Thank you. My name is David Hairston. I'm on the board of Appalachian Voice, president of the Walnut Tree Community Association, and an advocate for coal ash cleanup.
That's right.
I'm the person that the community calls. When young people are calling me to just have kids that are afraid to bathe their kids in their well water, I'm the ones that are older people are calling me that I don't fix income, that they have took their bottle of water away from them, that they're telling me they're scared to let their grandchildren come to their house because they'll go outside and play in the yard and be sick. I'm the person that they call and ask me, what are we going to do about that? I'm the person that they call when they say, I'll try to sell my home and I can't get a dime for it. I'm the person that they call and have no answer for them.
All right.
Thank you.
let's get started with this presentation. The coal ash impoundment or the basin covers an approximate area of about 270 acres and estimated containing, you know, estimated 12 million tons of ash. In April 1st, 2019, DEQ made a decision about the closure and directed you to fully excavate all the ash basins. At the end of last year, December 31st, at the end of a mitigation process, Duke submitted closure plans for closure by excavation of all the six sites. And Duke Energy, along with DEQ and other several community and environmental groups, entered into a settlement agreement that ended the litigation. Nine ash impoundments are identified across the six sites that had to be fully excavated for a total of 80 million tons of ash that would be excavated from the impoundment, and it will be stored in newly constructed double line landfill located at each site, on site. Approximately 4 million tons, 5% of impoundment ash will be left in place, but they will be covered with a synthetic impermeable closure cap system to prevent water infiltration. Stability features will be implemented to prevent ash movement and maintain, preserve the integrity of the structures by the end of 2029.
My name is Alfred Warren. I'm a lifelong resident. What type of guarantee do the people within the neighborhood and surrounding areas of the place have as far as the removal of it? How you gonna control the contaminants? Each and every one of us, we made a difference just because we took a stand and we say we care. We're all winners. It affects each and every one of us, especially if we have children. Don't some of you have children, grandchildren? That's who it was for. It was for the future. Our lives, we're passing on in our lives now, love. But we can make it better. We are making it better. We can make it better if all of us come on one accord and work together. When we came together on one accord, God came in the midst of it. God came in the midst of all of us and moved. When they said we couldn't do it, when God stepped into it, he let you know you can do it. All over the state of North Carolina, all up and down the eastern seaboard, we're coming together to make a difference. And we can, each and every one of us. We have to work together in love. Love is what's gonna make the difference. We can make the difference. And I'm making an appeal to each and every one of you tonight. Let us come together and make a difference right here in this town, right here, in this county, right here, and make those counties the place that he should be, in love. And each and every one of us, we can do that within ourselves. Thank you. God bless you.
It's the beginning of a new journey, because right now I want to make sure that the workers are protected. I want to make sure that the water is checked, that this doesn't cause another hazard. I want to make sure that our grandkids, great-grandkids, don't have to come back and fight this fight again, because even on the landfill, over maybe 50 to 100 years, something else could happen.
After tonight, and sometimes this week, you're gonna go back to your mom's house and tell her what happened?
I went there the day before I come here, and she and I had a long talk, and I could feel her telling me she was proud of me. She's here with me right now, so you just can't see her. Well, if I could have her back long enough to talk to her, it's like I said before, I'd like to apologize for all of the worry and the hurt that I may have caused you by being a wild teenager. And you know it's no doubt in your mind that I loved you from the bottom of my heart. And I hope that what I'm doing, I didn't make you very proud of me. When you were alive. But I hope by the next time I see you, that you'll be saying that's my son and I'm proud of you.
You got to move, you got to move, you got to move, child, you got to move. But one day long, get ready, you got to move. You got the move.